Imagine my skepticism when I get an email saying this: synthetic diamonds for quantum. I know, every time someone says quantum, I roll my eyes. Buzzword salad, wanna add AI or blockchain in there too? But then they said that the synthetic diamonds were not for quantum computing, but for quantum sensing. And that got my attention. And thus I fell down a quantum rabbit hole, one with implications for the semiconductor industry. In this video, we talk about diamond-based nitrogen vacancy center quantum sensors. No idea what that is? Well then, let's go find out. Let us begin with a girl's best friend. A diamond is a carbon crystal. Each carbon atom inside the diamond's lattice is bonded to four other carbon atoms. This rigid bond and compact structure is why the diamond is so famously hard. But this lattice is not always perfect. Quite frequently, we have distortions in the lattice where a carbon atom is replaced by an intruder. The most common such being nitrogen, but we sometimes get boron or silicon too. These lattice distortions are called color centers, and they give diamonds their nice colors. For example, high concentrations of nitrogen atoms make the diamond yellow. Color centers are also why some diamonds can glow or fluoresce when exposed to UV light, so that's nice. There are many type color centers, but the one we are looking at today is particularly special. Sometimes you have a diamond lattice defect where a nitrogen atom is in the lattice and bonded to three carbon atoms, but not a fourth, leaving a vacancy in the lattice. This specific defect type is generally called a nitrogen vacancy center, or NV center. It is very small, about 4 to 5 nanometers wide. In high enough quantity, this type of color center would make the diamond pink. It is also photoluminescent. When hit with green light, the color center glows red. More on that later. This defect has some very interesting atomic properties. Like traditional atoms, these NV centers can also capture and hold electrons. They have three stable energy states. First, there is an NV neutral center with 5 electrons, 2 from the nitrogen atom, and 3 unpaired electrons from the carbon atoms bordering the vacancy. The net charge is 0. There is also an NV plus center, with the NV center having lost an electron, so 4 electrons, giving it a net positive charge. The NV neutral and NV plus energy states have been studied and are generally not useful for our purposes today. Thus, finally, we get to the third state, which I shall hereby refer to as the NV negative center. Here, the NV center has captured an extra electron inside its lattice, likely from nearby nitrogen atoms, like a pearl stuck inside a piece of coral. It is at this point that we need to introduce the concept of spin. Subatomic particles, electrons, protons, and neutrons, quarks, and photons, have a fundamental quantum property called spin. The word spin implies that the particle is literally spinning around like that whirling top in Inception. And that is how physicists in the early 1900s originally pictured it, thusly the origin of the name. But that is not precisely what quantum spin is. What is it? Who knows? Not what this video is about. I read some stuff, and this is the best I can do. 1. It is an angular momentum, fundamental to the particle, and there are experiments proving that it exists. 2. It is quantized, meaning that it is measured in discrete values without a unit. 1, 1.5, 2, etc. 3. Again, it is not the spinning top. There are no classical physics metaphors that our primitive monkey brains can employ to understand it. 4, and quite important to our journey here, we can manipulate the spin using energy, most often in the form of microwave or laser pulses. So here's where we are now. The diamond's NV negative center has a spin associated with it, and we can use energy to essentially set, quote-unquote, that spin to a certain value. So what is a big deal with the NV negative center's spin? 2 things: coherence and fluorescence. Let us begin with coherence. Roughly speaking, coherence means that the quantum system is changing or evolving in a predictable and reversible manner. The reversible part is important because it means we can back it out. We can make sense of it. Quantum systems like qubits lose their coherence due to interactions with the outside world. So the more we try to measure a quantum system, the faster it loses its coherence. But the NV negative center's coherence is unusually strong. The diamond carbon 12 atoms surrounding it do not affect the spin, and the lattice's stiff covalent bonds keep the NV negative center with its trapped electron relatively isolated. So the NV negative center's spin coherence can be maintained for a long time, and even more remarkably, this is at room temperature. We might be able to extend coherence by freezing the diamond to very low temperatures. Scientists have since discovered other things to extend coherence, including something called dynamical decoupling. This is where we use pulses to periodically, quote-unquote, reset the spin and maintain coherence. It reminds me of like how noise-canceling headphones emit sound waves to make it seem quiet around you. But again, this coherence property by itself is not uber special, but this is where we mix in the second big thing, fluorescence. We can actually get information out from our NV negative center qubit via ordinary optical light. We can see the quantum, bro. In 1997, a team of scientists in Germany announced that they could see and track the NV negative center's spin transitions at room temperature. This was an earth-breaking, ground-shattering result at the time. How does it work? If you hit the NV negative center with an energetic pulse from a 532 nanometer green laser, you excite its electron up from its stable energy or ground state. Remarkably, this does not change the spin value. The excited electron now must return to the ground state, but the way in which it goes about this depends on its existing quantum spin. If the spin is one value, then it is more likely to emit a red photon. If it is another value, then it must go through a different intermediate energy state and is thus less likely to emit that red photon, maybe an infrared photon instead. Thusly, we can collect the NV negative center's spin values by reading the intensity of their collectively emitted red light. Changes in that light's intensity point to changes in the spin values. People took to calling this method optically detected magnetic resonance, or ODMR. So, we can set the NV negative center's spin to a knowable value. The diamond structure naturally protects it from bad outside influences. And finally, we can read out its spin state just by looking at it, all at room temperature. This is the killer app. Most early research focused on using diamond-based NV negative centers for compute. We can encode data into the NV negative center's state and then manipulate it, like the ones and zeros of classical transistor computing, a spin qubit. There is a type of quantum computing like this. In 1998, Daniel Loss and David DiVincenzo proposed a new type of quantum computer using individual electrons suspended in quantum dots as its spin qubits. Intel's quantum computer stuff relies on spin qubits too. But there has also been real commercial interest for using these NV negative centers for quantum sensing. Sensing of temperature, pressure, and electric fields, for instance, but particularly magnetic fields. I am simplifying a great deal, like a really, really great, great deal. But external magnetic fields cause the NV negative center to change how it emits light in a predictable way. Measuring these changes helps us map out the magnetic field. You might think of something like an MRI, and that was what I thought at first, but the MRI people do not seem to like that comparison. The methods are not the same. But I find the vision somewhat helpful, nevertheless. In a diamond-based quantum magnetic sensor, it is important that the NV negative centers be placed as close to the sample as possible. So a diamond sensor can take several forms. One arrangement is to have a bunch of NV negative centers arranged in a flat 2D layer close to the diamond's surface. In another setup, one better for 3D imaging, you put the special diamond and its NV negative centers into a scanning probe tip. During the scan, you energize the NV negative centers using green laser light. From there, you bring the diamond sensor close to the sample and expose both to a magnetic field. The magnetic field is affected by the subject, and these variations are picked up by the ensemble of NV centers in the form of emitted light. The light can be picked up by either a laser or a very sensitive array of CMOS photodetectors. Using computer software, we can use the data to generate a detailed map of the magnetic fields and thus the sample. For more information, we sweep microwaves at a specific wavelength over the NV negative centers to manipulate their spin states. This changes the centers' quantum states and thus their fluorescence. This is not Star Trek stuff. Existing magnetic field-based sensing solutions using other receivers do exist. For example, alkali atom vapor cells are sealed silicon chambers with alkali atomic gases inside and a window to peek through. They leverage existing MEMS and microfabrication techniques. And then there are superconducting quantum interference devices, or SQUIDs. They leverage the superconductor's extreme sensitivity to magnetic fields for very fine imaging of biological structures like the brain. SQUIDs work quite well, very mature tech, but being superconductors, they have to operate in super cold temperatures, which limits their practicality. Diamond-based quantum magnetic sensors need less of that peripheral equipment, so they can be made physically smaller and thus moved very close to the sample in question. And since the NV center is an atom-sized sensor, remember, they are about 4 to 5 nanometers wide, we can employ an ensemble of them to get unprecedented, maybe even nanoscale, resolution on our images. Key to all of this is the diamond. Without the right diamond, none of this works. And these diamonds are nuts. Not literally. In nature, color centers are caused by ion or electron radiation damage. It's pretty much random. So there is absolutely no way that natural diamonds can have thousands of these specific lattice defects, and none others, distributed in the desired arrangement. And you need far more than one for commercialization. Ergo, every quantum-grade diamond needs to be specifically grown using modern microwave CVD processes like what I discussed in a prior video. Methods vary, but the diamond is largely produced like as I mentioned in that video. You start with a seed diamond produced with CVD or high-pressure, high-temperature methods. Then you immerse it in microwave-produced plasma, slowly growing diamond layers on top of the seed. Producing a quantum-grade diamond, however, adds a few complications. As I mentioned earlier, we want the diamond NV centers to be as close to the sample as possible. If the intended diamond sensor is a flat plate shape, then the layer has to be very near the surface. So you use ion implantation tools from the semiconductor industry to fire an ion beam of nitrogen atoms into the diamond lattice at the surface, embedding them into the crystal. Since the arrangement of the NV centers is important too, we may even employ a mask and resist to make sure the right pattern is put down into the diamond layer. In other words, lithography. Yes, finely patterned diamond chips made with lithography. After removing the resist, a high temperature annealing step done in a vacuum would produce the atomic vacancies next to the embedded nitrogen atoms to complete the NV defect. And in case you're wondering, the resulting diamond seems to look brown, or reddish brown. Every other type of defect must be removed, so after cutting the diamond, it needs to be very carefully polished using acid, very fine particles, or even semiconductor-grade dry etching techniques. None of this is easy. Diamond-based quantum sensing has clear benefits in medical imaging. MRIs are a big deal, but there is also a semiconductor's play. One current major trend in the semiconductor world is the growing prominence of advanced packaging. For instance, TSMC's CoWoS, which puts together things like the NVIDIA H100 AI accelerator, or high bandwidth memory, or HBM, the current hot thing in the memory industry today. Advanced packaging techniques are moving very fast right now, but their sophistication might have perhaps run a bit ahead of our ability to measure and test them. It is hard to overstate just how important testing and failure analysis are to fast production cycles and good yields. Chips take 4 to 6 months and 1,000 process steps to produce. It's super important to find small problems early. And indeed, there are many ways for an advanced package to go wrong. For instance, HBM chips have these through silicon vias, or TSVs, and micro bumps between the vertically stacked memory dies, carrying interconnects. These TSVs are already a few micrometers wide and need to get thinner so we can stuff more of them onto the dies. But being so deep inside this vertically stacked structure, it's not easy to check them for cracks or voids. So fabs want tools that not only are sensitive to nanometer-sized issues, but also be easy and fast to prepare and run. And also, since it is scanning production items on the line, scans cannot negatively affect the package. Magnetic field imaging has a lot of potential in this, because these magnetic fields can easily pass through packaging materials and are very sensitive to weak currents buried deep inside the package. As I mentioned, NV centers offer superior physical traits over squids, and that nanoscale spatial resolution also comes incredibly handy as TSVs shrink and shrink. I do believe there is some real value here. Before we close, I want to thank the startup Quantum Diamonds out in Germany for suggesting this idea. There remains a lot of questions about the future viability of quantum computing, like what is it even going to be useful for? So to me, quantum sensing is a great deal more viable. I heard it jokingly said at IMEC's ITF World 2024 conference that the same things that make quantum computing so much of a pain in the butt also make it a very excellent quantum sensor. This video particularly focuses on semiconductor applications, but much of the research has focused on using it for biology and medical use cases. Imagine a far smaller medical imaging device with unprecedented resolution. That is the dream of diamond-based quantum sensing, and I look forward to seeing more of this entering the market in the future. All right, everyone, that's it for tonight. Thanks for watching. Subscribe to the channel, sign up for the Patreon, and I'll see you guys next time.